Welcome back to the Academy of Light. Today we're going to be dealing with the Forerunners. If you remember in the last session we took, we looked at the formation of a kingdom in the earth that would dominate nations in the world. A new world order, a new kingdom, and how that is being formed right now through the economic situation, politics, and so on. So we see a world order, a world bank, a world church coming into being. And we see all of this happening. And there's a clash between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent, Satan. And this clash now is becoming apparent. And today, we're going to deal with a theme in Scripture which is not very understood much at all. And it's the theme or the thought of the forerunners. And so today we're going to be looking at that. Forerunners basically are those who go ahead of the others. They're ahead of the main body of the church. For instance, Joshua and Caleb were forerunners. They went into the promised land and they came back with a good report telling the people, now, you can do this. You can come into this place. This is what's out there. You can come. They were forerunners. They went ahead and came back to the church and start to prepare them for the whole of Israel to enter in. But we know that most of the church, most of Israel didn't enter in at that time. And so it was only Joshua and Caleb who eventually in that generation got in. Enoch was a forerunner. And we have, you know, his example for us to today. It's possible for us to walk with God like Enoch walked with God. He was a forerunner, and his life serves to teach us that if he can do it, we can do it. Jesus was a forerunner. He went before as an example to his disciples who were to follow him. For instance, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 20, it says, but now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. So Christ is risen from the dead and become the first fruits. Or in other words, he became the first to experience resurrection. All right? He was the first fruit so that others could follow in his footsteps. In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 23, it says, but every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, and afterwards they that are Christ at his coming. Okay. He was the first to experience resurrection. Now, in Revelation chapter 14 and verse 4, it tells us this. It says, these are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. And so here's a group of people again who are first fruits. They went ahead of the others. They were redeemed from among men. And it says, these are they which were not defiled with women. Actually, the original says, these are they who were not defiled with the woman. And it's really talking about Babylon, the woman, Babylon. They had come to a place where there was no inroads of Babylon. They were not defiled by the Babylonian system. And in that condition, they were pure. They were chaste. They were virgins. And these are them which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. They were redeemed from among men. They were first fruits, you see. And the first fruits always have those who will follow after them. They are the first of a company that is coming in behind them. The devil also has first fruits, but kind of in reverse. They are the first fruits examples of the Antichrist. For instance, when mentioned, there's a man mentioned in Scripture by the name of Antiochus Epiphanes. He was around about 167 BC, and his name really means God manifest. He hated the Jews. He plundered the temple in Jerusalem. He offered a pig on the altar of the temple in Jerusalem on the altar. He was a picture of the coming Antichrist. He was a type. And from Satan's camp, he was a forerunner of what was really coming. Some teach that Nero was the Antichrist. No, he wasn't the Antichrist. The Antichrist has not been revealed yet, but he had an Antichrist spirit. And John said, many Antichrists have gone out into the world. Some people, Hitler, Stalin, and so on, they were forerunners. They were pictures of what was to come. Now, it's really important to understand the principle of the first fruits, or we'll have real problems and we'll have a lot of confusion. Like we said in the last teaching series, we said that there is compound confusion in the body of Christ regarding the rapture. And I said, I believe in the rapture. The Lord's going to descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, the trump of God, the dead shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up to be with the Lord forever. Now, the word rapture does not appear in Scripture, but it's an English word that is used to describe an experience of being caught up together with the Lord, to be caught up, to be raptured. And in Revelation chapter 12, there appeared a great wonder in heaven. A woman, which was clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried, travailing in birth, pain to be delivered. So here we have this wonder. She appears in the heavenlies. It's a woman, clothed with the sun, moon under her feet, upon her head a crown of 12 stars. She's pregnant, travailing in birth. And so we see this woman here. There is a company in the church ready to come to birth before the others. These are forerunners. These are the first of the seed of the woman to mature. There will be others that will follow, but these are forerunners. And so we have this picture of the woman, which is the church, in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 1. Clothed with the sun, the moon under her feet. She had been with child, travailed. Now, another wonder appears in heaven in Revelation 12 and verse 3. And there appeared another wonder in heaven. And behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads, 10 horns, 7 crowns upon his head. And his tail drew a third part of the stars of heaven and cast them into the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to deliver her child as soon as it was born. And so we have a picture of the church in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 1, a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, a picture of the church. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns. So we have the Antichrist kingdom at the same time as the church is about to bring forth a man-child. So the powers of the Antichrist kingdom are going to try and kill this seed that is coming to maturity. And it's coming to the fullness. And it says in Revelation chapter 12, verse 5, and she brought forth a man-child, who was to rule the nations with a rod of iron, and a child was caught up to God and to his throne. All right. Now, there are two women mentioned in Scripture. The Revelation 12, the woman is a church, and Revelation 17 is the false church or the harlot church. And in Revelation 12, this church brings forth, this woman brings forth what the Bible says is a man-child. A fully matured, it's a child, fully matured child, a man child. And she's caught up, it's caught up to the throne. A experience, if you like, kind of rapture. Caught up to the throne of God and is caught away. Now, what happens to this woman who is left? She gives birth to a company of believers, forerunners, were caught up to the throne of God. And what happens to the woman? Well, the Bible is very, very clear. Because now the rest of the church, the woman, is at the mercy of the Antichrist kingdom, which is formed in the earth. Revelation 12, 6, and the woman fled into the wilderness, where she had a place prepared for of God, that they should feed her there 1,260 days, which is roughly 3.5 years. So the woman fled into a wilderness where there was a place prepared for her, that they should feed her. Who should feed her? And what is this wilderness? Where is this wilderness? And who's feeding this church in the wilderness? Okay. The church brings, out of the church comes a group of people who have come to the fullness of stature of Christ. They've come to this maturity. They are sons of God. They are caught up to the throne of God to receive their commissions for their final stages of this on the earth. And they're caught away for a period of time. The woman then flees into the wilderness from the Antichrist, where there is a place prepared of God for 3.5 years for her. It's almost like the church goes underground at that point, but not in the sense that we understand underground, but the visible, structured church disappears. There's still millions of believers, but the visible, structured church is gone. And verse 14 of Revelation 12 tells us the woman was given two wings of a great eagle that she might fly into the wilderness unto a place where she is nourished for a time, times and half time from the face of the serpent. All right, this eagle. Who is this eagle? I've heard people say, well, it's America because she has the symbol of the eagle. No, really doesn't mean that. And the woman was given two wings of a great eagle. What were these wings? You see, these wings, that she might fly into the wilderness. See, and eagles are symbolic of the prophets. And the prophetic words of the eagles given to the church and direction in that time to hide them, to bring them to a place where they will be protected, to bring them to a place where they're innominous, as the structure, the normal structured church vanishes from sight, but the people are still there. And, you know, this word wilderness in the Greek language is the word eremos, and it has the meaning of a separated place or a solitary place. And there's a place prepared, you see, in the spirit for these people. And she is nourished there for 3.5 years. What is happening in those 3.5 years? Well, it's the final touches of preparing the bride. And so we have these forerunners who come out of the church, caught up to the throne of God, caught up to throne room authority and power and insight and understanding. And the church then is caught away into a wilderness and a protected place. I told you about those domes, you know, in the last session, where these domes covered so many people and nourished for 3.5 years. Who is nourishing this church? Who is nourishing them? The forerunners who were called up to the throne of God. They are the first fruits of the rapture. They are the first fruits who will protect the woman, the church in the wilderness, and feed her there and prepare her as a bride. And during these 3.5 years, the church will be protected, taught, ministered to, and the bride will be prepared. The Bible tells us this, because she will be prepared and made ready for the rapture. The bride has made herself ready. Song of Solomon, chapter 3 and verse 6 reads like this. Who is this that cometh out of the wilderness like pillars of smoke, perfumed with myrrh and frankincense, with all powders of the merchant? Okay, who is it? It's the bride. And finally, it will come out of that wilderness place, that solitary place, that protected place, that place where she has been prepared by the man-child, those who went ahead and experienced rapture before them. They protects her, and now she's coming out of the wilderness. She's finally ready as a bride without spot or wrinkle, ready to be raptured. The woman, the church, has escaped the Antichrist, and now he is furious. Now listen to me carefully. The church went into the wilderness. Then they were prepared in that wilderness. And out of the wilderness, who is this that comes out of the wilderness? It is the bride, prepared by the man-child, nurtured and fed by the man-child. And so comes out of the wilderness and is caught up. So see, the rapture takes place. Now, the ominous part is this. Chapter 12 of Revelation, verse 17, it says, "And then the dragon was angry with the woman because he lost her. And he went then to make war with the remaining of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ." These are Christians. You see, the remnant of her seed. So the church escapes, the woman escapes, the bride is caught up. But there's still some people here in the earth, the remnant of her seed, and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. So there's some still left. Sure, they're Christians. Revelation 13 and verse 7 tells us this, "And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations." Who is these people? After the church is raptured, the bride has gone, and it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. See, the dragon was angry. He had lost bride. He's lost the woman, the church there. And he went to make war with the remnant of her seed. These, which are Christians, keep the commandments of God, have the testimony of Jesus Christ. It was given him to make war with them and overcome them. You see, remember Jesus was sowing the seed, and the seed were the children of the kingdom. Some brought forth 60-fold. They're in the holy place. It's the church that's caught into the wilderness for the final preparation on them to become the bride. You see, and the hundredfold were those, the man-child, the forerunners who went ahead to prepare a place for them. You know, the church who had matured to 60-fold had another 3.5 years in which to prepare in the wilderness, with the man-child ministering to her, feeding her, assisting her, the forerunners nourished her. You know, the Bible tells us that as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days in which we are living today. You know, a lot of people were around in the days of Noah. Enoch was alive, and quite a lot of other people. The Bible tells us that Enoch walked with God, and one day God just took him. He was a picture of the man-child. He was a picture of the hundredfold company. And Enoch, you know, saw what was coming. Because it tells us in Jude chapter 1, verse 14, "And Enoch also, the seventh from heaven, prophesied of these, saying, Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints." So he saw the coming of the Lord. He saw right down to the end of the age. And Enoch's life was prophetic of a specific group of people in the end time church. These forerunners, these sons of God. He was, you know, the seventh generation from Adam. And seven is the number of completeness. He was completed. And just as there are a group of people who will be completed into the image and likeness of Jesus, will be walking with him, these forerunners, this man-child, seventh from Adam, completed. He saw the coming of the Lord. And Enoch's father was a man named Jared, who was the direct descendant of Seth. So Enoch was the seventh generation from Adam. So Enoch was born 622 years after Adam was created. This means that Adam was alive when Enoch was born. All right. And Enoch was a contemporary of Adam. He knew Adam and contemporary of Adam for 305 years. And so he knew Adam very, very, very well. He talked with Adam a lot. He sat on Adam's knee asking him what it was like to be in the garden, what it was like to walk with God. And Adam told him many, many, many things. And Enoch found a way. He was so fired up that Enoch found a way to walk with God and experience, rapture, as it were. He walked with God after the fall. Now, if he can walk with God after the fall, we can walk with God after redemption, after the cross. As it was in the days of Noah, Jesus said, so shall be in the days of the Son of Man. So, Methuselah, Enoch's son, lived for 969 years. He was ready to go by then. And he died. And the year that he died, the flood came. Enoch's generation was alive right up to the flood. He was alive. Enoch was alive when God said, my spirit shall not always strive with man. He was alive when God brought this world, their world, to an end. And we will be alive when God brings this world to an end as we know it. As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in our day. Three categories of people were in the days of Noah, which we need to understand. Enoch, translated, picture of the man-child, the forerunners. Noah and his family, who rode through the storm in a wilderness. This time it was a wilderness of water, but nevertheless a wilderness, and protected during the storm. And there were those who died in the flood, three categories of people. Hundredfold, 60, 40. Likewise, so shall it be in these end times. There are three categories of people in Revelation chapter 12. The woman, or the church, which would become the bride. There was the man-child, which the woman gave birth to. And there were those who died in the flood. Enoch was caught up to the throne of God. These were those who became loved. These are the man-child. These are the ones who reached a level of conformity to the image of Jesus while still living here in the flesh. And so we see, in their day, it's the same. There were three categories of people. Enoch, man-child, the family of Noah, which rode through the storm or wilderness, and those who were sometimes disobedient in the days of Noah, who lost their lives in the flood. In the tabernacle, the three areas, the outer court, the holy place. See, the outer court is open to the element. It's not covered. There was no dome, transparent dome there. Open. The holy place was covered, you see. The church was called away into the wilderness, but covered. The holiest of all, the manifest presence of God, the throne room, Enoch, the man-child, ruling the nations. The days of Noah, Enoch, the church in the ark, and those who died in the flood. The Bible speaks about these people in Enoch's day who died in the flood. And it talks about them in 1 Peter 3, verse 19, by which he went and preached unto the spirits in prison. In other words, there was a chance for them. And verse 20 of 1 Peter 3, which sometimes, this group was sometimes disobedient when the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah while the ark was in preparation, wherein few, that is, eight souls, were saved by water. Now look, you don't want to end up in this last group. You don't want to end up. At least you've got to get out of that 40-fold. And how many of you know, if Lot had stayed in Sodom, even though he was a righteous man, if he had stayed in Sodom, he would have died. If he didn't hear what God was saying, If we don't hear what God is saying through the prophets in these days, you will be in dire straits. We need to hear the wings of those eagles. We need to hear what they're saying. And so Peter said, you know, 2 Peter 3:11, seeing that all these things are going to be dissolved, these things are going to happen, what manner of person ought you to be in holy conversation and godliness? Okay. God is preparing a seed that will mature ahead of the rest. These are forerunners. And in Obadiah chapter 1 and verse 21, it says this, and saviors, this is not the Lord Jesus savior, but saviors shall come up on Mount Zion and judge the Mount of Esau, and then the kingdom shall become the Lord's. So out of Zion, there's going to come a group of people, saviors, going to protect the church, prepare the bride. And they'll go forth in the earth, guarding, watching over the bride in the wilderness 3.5 years until he has finally prepared the bride. Jesus said, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear what he's saying. And we need ears. We need understanding. We need to be like the tribe of Issachar, who had understanding of the days in which they lived, and they knew what they should do. What must we do? Realize it's not business as usual anymore. We're not playing church. We have to become earnest. We have to become focused. We must pursue a walk with God like never before. You see, we are told, Jesus told us to watch. It implies being alert. Have understanding of what's going on. Being alert. Give more earnest heed, the Bible says, to what God is saying, and respond to it. Paul said, press towards the mark. Diligently seek him. That implies consistency. Pray, Jesus said, that you might escape these things that are coming on the face of the earth. Redeeming the time, because the days are evil. In other words, make up for lost time. We are rapidly approaching the point. In Revelation 10:6, it says, and he swore by him that liveth forever and ever, who created the heavens and the things that are in the earth, and the earth and the things that are there are therein are, and the sea and the things which are there, that time should be no longer. Time should be no longer. We're reaching a point when there's no longer time to prepare. Reaching a point where things come to an end and there's no more time for the bride to prepare herself. Let us pray. Lord, I just pray that truth might impact those who are hearing this word today, that your word might find a place within their hearts, that their understanding might be enlightened through the spirit of revelation, that they might be motivated to press on to the high calling in Christ Jesus. As Paul said, I press towards that mark, giving them understanding and insight, Lord, motivating them to be earnest, that they might be found at least among the company of the church who's caught into the wilderness. Lord, there are those who are coming forth, sons of God, forerunners, who will come back from the throne of God and say to the church, you're able to do it. And protects them and nourishes them for 3.5 years until the bride has made herself ready. Lord, I pray, give us understanding and determination to walk with you. In Jesus' name. Amen.